a real person.
Hello, everybody.
Hi.
Hello. Hi, everybody.
Hello, Juan Carlos here.
Hello.
Hello. Oh, my lighting's horrible.
Hello. Hi. Hi, everybody.
Hello, good evening.
I am busy admitting a ton of people, so we're going to just pause and wait for everyone here. Hi, Matt.
Howdy.
You're going to see a picture of my dog, Honey. She's 90 years old today, so happy birthday to her.
Aw. Happy birthday. All right. People are rolling in. Oh, my gosh. Okay. All right. We have 85 people here. This is exciting. We're expecting about 165, I believe.
Wow.
Great turnout for Chris Chien. Rocking it, Chris.
Thanks, Melody.
Yeah. All right. I'm still, babysitting the wait list here. Okay. I have someone waiting named someone, and I don't think I should let them in. It doesn't sound safe. All right, so we're going to get started. Hi, everybody. Welcome to this concept art class with Chris Chien, the concept art workshop for theme park artists. And we're very happy to have you all here. And this is, I think, the second or third Slice event we've done virtually. So this is really exciting. We're really loving this way of doing business. And introducing people to each other and to all different types of workshops and things that we can all learn together while we're on this quarantine experience together. So I wanted to thank Chris Chien for joining us today. He is a concept designer, and he's been working in the entertainment field, working in theme parks and video games and the movie industries. And he's been working for all sorts of different companies, Universal, Sesame Street, SeaWorld, Kennedy Space Center, Ferrari World. I know he was working for a while at BRPH with a bunch of friends over there too in the Orlando area. And we're just really excited to have him here today. So thank you, Chris, for being with us. And you can find his website is at chris-chien.com. That's C-H-I-E-N.com. If you haven't been to the site, go and take a look. All right, so I have a couple of little, laundry list things to get through here. And the first is we are having another Slice event on May 26th, the day after Memorial Day. And that is at 8 p.m. Eastern time. So that means 5 p.m. for you West Coasters. So I hope you guys can make it. It's a virtual mixer. And we're going to have a bunch of different breakout rooms. We're going to all talk to each other about a bunch of different things going on. The breakout rooms will be anything from very social to talking about work-related stuff and giving our elevator speeches so we can all network and meet each other. So I hope you guys will join us for that. Well, without further ado, I'd like to introduce Chris. And right before that, I do have one more thing to say. Sorry, Chris. And that is that if you guys have any questions, I'm going to turn off your video and audio during this presentation. And if you have any questions or concerns or comments or anything, use the chat and I will be monitoring the chat. So we're also going to have a break at about 8:30 and 30 minutes or 25 minutes and where Chris can address a lot of our questions during that time period. So if it can wait, then great. And if not, then I'll answer as we go, okay? So without further ado, I'm going to turn off your mics and your videos at this point, and we're gonna focus on Chris. So welcome, Chris Chien.
All right, hey everybody, how's it going? Thank you so much for the introduction, Melody. How's the sound? Everybody hear me all right?
Yes.
Okay. So yeah, thanks so much for coming out. I'm a little bit nervous. I'm definitely really happy.
Oh no.
Audience. And I think there's a lot of really like, oh, shoot. I'm getting a lot of
Chris.
Uh-oh. Yeah, yeah. I'm hearing a lot of audio. Is that me?
It's like my boss handled it. I just don't know.
Oh, shit.
Hold on.
Hang on. What if Chris, bear with me 1 second, okay?
Okay, yeah.
Okay, Chris?
Yes.
Okay, you're good. I muted everyone except for you.
Oh, okay, great. Thank you, Melody. So So this is a concept art workshop for theme park artists. I'm really excited to kind of present today. I see a lot of friends in the audience. Oh, that's my friend Darius. Okay, cool. So what are we gonna be doing today? Oops. So I thought it would be really cool if in the chat, you can type kind of like what you do and like if you're a student, a professional, if you are, what like field you're in, like what discipline did you study? Architecture, interior design, concept design, engineering, graphic designers, show set designers, producing. Can you go ahead and like kind of see haunted, okay, theme park graphic design student, professional haunted attraction industry, architect designer, Ringling College, cool, awesome, 3D modeler, generalist, illustrator, awesome, landscape architect, creative director, BIM, theater, interior designer, SCAD, okay, cool, gallery tech. Whoa, man, these are coming in really quick. This is really good. Cool. Art director, special effects engineer, creative service manager. Cool. Yeah, I wish you can see the chat. Well, you can see the chat, actually. But cool. I'll go ahead and go to the next slide. Thanks so much for kind of typing stuff in. So our agenda for today is... Oh. All right, in this workshop, we're gonna see some cool art. We're gonna create a composition based on photo reference. We're gonna talk a little bit about line art, vanishing points, perspective. We're gonna talk about color palettes and why color isn't important and what's more important than color in terms of like a concept art illustration. Dropping people into your illustration and creating sparkle and glam in your painting. So I don't think there's a lot of people in the audience that purely want to become a concept artist or illustrator, but they're probably just looking for tips, you know, kind of. So this is more like, we're talking less about foundation and more, it's like a magazine article. Here are 6 tips you can do to improve your concept illustration. This is kind of how I structured this talk so that it's useful and helpful to everybody. Our agenda, we're going to do a quick introduction. I'll have a process breakdown and then we'll be able to take some questions and then we'll do a demonstration and that will be live. And I think that will be really fun. All right. Hold on. Give me 1 second, you guys. Better. Cool. All right. So how I learned concept art, I think in the theme entertainment business, we talk a lot about story. So I'll talk about my story real quick. How I studied a little bit at Art Center College of Design. Then I went to Carnegie Mellon University and then Concept Design Academy. Okay, so let's see. Now I'm gonna start, give me 1 second. I need to do something called, this is gonna be really cool, you guys. New share, and we're gonna go into my Safari screen. Here it is. Awesome. Cool. Oh, geez, it looks like the video doesn't load when screen sharing is on. But it's okay. It's okay. But anyways, this was a school in Pasadena, and okay, the video's on. I was able to take some classes there when I was a high schooler on the weekends, and I was able to learn a lot about product and transportation design. So that's kind of like this type of rendering stuff. And I wanted to show you one of my most influential teachers, that had a really big impact on me. His name was Tony Yao, and he was kind of like Gordon Ramsay. He demands a lot from his students. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I thought it was really fun. So I'm just going to show you some of my high school work. And I think that you can see how this kind of started me on that. Cool. What the? Give me a sec. Okay, and this kind of got me started on a journey, because we had to build like models and exhibits to showcase our work. So this is me right here. This is me over here when I was in high school. This is some of my work. Basically, the project at NASA was we needed to like imagine what life would be like on Mars. So we created like different like Mars rovers and stuff. And I created like this little habitat. This was my model. I got to make it in the gallery. And some of the like the quality of work in high school was pretty good. So this is one of my classmates. His name was Yasu Sato. He currently works at Renault in France. But like this is like high schoolers doing these renderings, and it was like, wow, like he definitely, there was a lot of competition from the classmates, and I think this is super cool. This is me over here, and like NASA came and they did like a little interview with us. I learned a lot, so much from this teacher. So you know, this is how I kind of got started, and some of the other courses were also really cool. Like this is another really cool one I wanted to show you guys. I actually wasn't in this class, but they were doing like a construction vehicle thing and they had to build this. So just to give you an idea of like the timeline, we're looking at 10 weeks. They did all of this in 10 weeks. So these high schoolers had to do 10 pages of rendering, something like this, a week for 5 weeks. And after the 5 weeks, they needed to build the models as well as the entire exhibit. And I think it's inspiring. Some people might find this demoralizing because, man, like this is really stressful to produce this amount of work, but I get inspired by looking at this type of stuff. And this teacher was really influential towards me. And I'm sure in the theme park industry, we know how to like, we have to do like really tight deadlines and stuff like that. So I'm sure like some of you guys can relate. Let's see, what else? Okay. So then afterwards, I went to a school called Carnegie Mellon University for the industrial design program. And I'm gonna show you, oh, this is some of my work from high school. As you can see, this is that style, that art center style. This was for like a vehicle that can go into the water as well as become a motorcycle. It's kind of like a fantasy type of thing. But when I went to university, I really struggled. And maybe some of you guys have felt that way as well. This stuff, you know, it wasn't really entertainment-like. I'm sure like if you come from like interior design or architecture background, a lot of times they look down upon like the entertainment field, like it's not as serious. Kind of like a lot of times if you're studying architecture, it's like really serious things like Frank Gehry or something like that. And if it's entertainment-y, it's deemed as less valuable. Kind of like how some film critics feel like Marvel movies don't qualify as cinema. So I was here and I was struggling a little bit, but there was a silver lining, and that was I did something called Booth. Yeah, exactly, Robert. Yeah, exactly. People might think it's like silly and stuff. I'm gonna narrate over this video. So during the springtime, and you guys can hear the audio. Oh, that Nibdan booth, awesome. There's something, it's like building a haunted house. And I was like the concept designer, art director for this. So here's like a little model. So we're building this like house in the springtime. And like these are all hand-painted murals and interactives. And we built everything in like a little garage. And it was, I thought I was really proud of myself, you know, and I had a lot of fun working with a really great team. And this is something that was, you don't get any credit for it. Something you just do for fun on top of a full course load. And at this point, I didn't even know that you could become a theme park designer. Like there was theme entertainment, that type of thing. But here I was starting to realize, hey, I enjoy this kind of like exhibit immersive design sort of thing, even though I wasn't really sure what it was. But the story here was that you're like a Pokemon master, you know, trainer, you're going into the forest, then you go into a cave. So this cave is called the Onyx Cave. It's, here are some conceptual sketches of it. It gets kind of scary. You see some ghost Pokemon. So now you're kind of in a dimly lit room. There's Pokemon flying above you. There's like a bubble machine. So yeah, kind of haunted house-like. If you've done haunted houses before, you can probably be like, oh yeah, I've done something like that. These sculptures, they were made of like paper mache and chicken wire. Like really, just really, you know, scraps and stuff. So this was the climax, the finale. And we go into this room and we're battling Team Rocket. And we play this little game where you have to like roll this Pokeball into the right thing to get like effective damage or not very effective damage. So this is the game. And what happens is that when you land the catapult, like the Pokemon like pops out. So yeah, like a little carnival game. Yeah, we ended up getting first place, not just for our division, but the entire school. So that was definitely a really proud moment for us. Cool, thanks guys. Let me see, now what do I need to do? Now I need to new share. I need to go back here. All right, now you're looking at this again. Cool. So unfortunately, this didn't really have a happy ending. I think this is really relevant because I graduated in 2010. That was when the 2008, you know, crash was. And I had no idea. When I was a college student, I was just focused on my schoolwork, you know? And I graduated and I was having trouble getting a job and I didn't really know why. And I realized like, hey, my portfolio wasn't really strong enough to get a job as a concept artist. And I thought one of the reasons was, look, I was taking maybe one art class a semester versus like people who've taken seven art classes every semester for the past 4 years. So at Carnegie Mellon, definitely they had us become more of a generalist, you know, a little bit of everything. And the job market was not just competitive for new grads, but a lot of people were laid off and you were competing with them for jobs as well. Let's see what happens. So I guess the lesson I learned was like, hey, don't get complacent, you know, always be improving yourself. Yeah, sure. Okay, cool. Let me see what's going on. But yeah, give me a second. So I'll go ahead and start. Give me a sec here. Strength, walking breakdown. Okay. Here we go. Give me a second. Let me start getting into the art. Part two. Okay, give me a second. All right. Here, got it. Got it. Cool. All right, you guys. So I'm going to be talking about, I'm going to go ahead and be talking about my process for this. You guys can see this, right? Let's try and can. Okay, cool. All right. So this is a piece that I've done for my portfolio. I think that it'll be really interesting to show you guys the process. Okay. So the first thing I would do was start gathering reference images. And this was kind of a fun piece where I wanted to do something kind of Chinese inspired, but also inspired by video games. So I went ahead and grabbed some reference images. So a lot of concept art pieces actually start with a photo comp on top of something that's existing. So I'm not actually, you know, designing what a flat ride or swing ride looks like. I'm just overlaying on top of it. Because, you know, we're called theme parks, right? We're kind of overlaying a theme on top of it. For this particular concept, unless I'm doing like Ride of the Resistance, you know, I'm not doing something completely original. So as you can see here, I went ahead and started sketching on top of it. And of course, you can see that there's some things that weren't quite there. But there was something a little bit missing. I started doing some hand sketching because I felt like this was a little bit too sterile. So I kind of printed it out and then I went into like drawing it by hand. And I kind of like did photocopies of it and printed it out really lightly and then kind of like a final version of it. So as you can see of this compared to this, you know, this kind of lacks a little bit of life and the nuance. And when I drew it by hand, it just has a lot more life to it. Okay. Yeah, so I went ahead and overlaid this on top of the photo that I originally had, and I started adjusting it. And yeah, you can see here, I'm referencing the schematic drawing from the ride vendor because I'm making sure that it's accurate. Right here. And here you can see I'm compiling everything together. I had some photos and I kind of traced over it to make everything really consistent. All right, here I'm putting the basic layers in. I'm not worrying about shadow at this point. I'm gonna do that a little bit later. And here I'm starting to put the people in, some more of the detail. And here I'm just focusing on the shadows. And you can see that this will unify everything together. Here's the ambient occlusion layer. And here is the highlight layer. And when I put everything together, boom, it's kind of like a sound mixing. Okay. Oh yeah, so you know what? What should I do now? I think I'll go ahead and show you my Photoshop file so you can kind of see what that looks like. New share, I'm gonna share. Oh, I need to open Photoshop first. Cool. Oh wait, hold on, give me a sec. Here we go. Awesome. Okay, so this is Photoshop. All right. And I have a lot of layers here, but I think I'm pretty organized. This is my effects layer. This is like the sun and everything like that. Here's the people on a separate layer. Here are my highlight layers. I can turn that on and off. Ambient occlusion. Shadows. Here's my shadow. It kind of unifies everything together. Here are the lanterns. Here's the fence. The back people. The line art. People, planters, the ride. Stuff. Okay. I think, hold on, give me a sec. I need to switch back into the people demo. Very cool. All right. Oh, no. Okay. All right, you guys. Very cool. Okay, cool. So what I thought would be really cool would be to show you how I drop in people into my drawings. So it's something we can do in a relatively short amount of time. And I'll go ahead and show you my folder. Some people are like, where do you get all those photos of people? You can download them online, like PNGs, or I actually took pictures of people. And here's a quick tip. Take pictures of people during a cloudy day. This way you don't have really harsh shadows. So I went to Universal City Walk, where there's a lot of pictures, well, a lot of people taking pictures everywhere, you know? So it doesn't look weird. It just looks like you're taking a picture of the building, you know? And I just took pictures of people walking around. And you can see I kind of gathered all the people. And this step is optional, but I would like draw over them a little bit. And then I would cut them out. And I would have people cutouts like this. And this really helps speed things up. So hopefully this is like helpful to you guys. Like I would go to a photo op and I would take pictures of people taking photos because, you know, these type of photo people, they're really useful in a theme park drawing. Okay, awesome. So I'll go ahead and show you how I do people. Give me a sec. So I'm switching back to Photoshop again. Okay. You know what? This feels really, I'm gonna play a little bit of music, okay? This helps calm me down a little bit. Right. Here you go. Awesome. All right. You guys can see my, no, not yet. You guys can see my screen. Not yet, right? Okay. Hold on. Hold on. Awesome. Okay. Now you guys can see my Photoshop file. Okay. Perfect. Whew. All right. Sorry, guys. I'm a little bit nervous. Okay. So you can see how I have the shadows on a different layer. I have cast shadows on a different layer. I'm gonna go ahead and show you how I just did that. I'm taking out my tablet here, drawing on a little tablet. No, are you serious? I can't find my Wacom pen. Ah. Hey guys, I'm sorry, just give me a minute. Melody, you wanna like take over, distract them a little bit, maybe?
Sure.
I found it. It was on like my coffee table for some reason. I don't know why it was there. Okay, but I have it. Okay.
Good save, good save. Cause I didn't know what I was about to do. I was about to start tap dancing or something.
Okay, it's okay. I'm human.
That's my worst nightmare. If I lose my Wacom pen. Okay. All right, you ready to go?
I'm ready to go.
Goodbye, everyone.
Okay. Thanks, guys. All right. So, how many of you guys have trouble placing people and making sure they're at the exact scale? I know I sure have. And this is like a little trick. It's called hanging the heads or something like that. Basically, hold on. The technique is this. This only works for certain vantage points, so this wouldn't work for an aerial view. But if this was drawn from the view of like of a regular person, if the camera is at your head level view, this line over here will be the horizon line and everybody will be on that line. So if someone's smaller, their head would still be there over here. And if they're in the back, their head still would be over here. And let's say they're really big in the foreground, this is where their head would be. Like this is like, let's say they're pointing like that. I'm sure you've had trouble with this before because it's like, you wanna make someone really big and you're scooting them up, you're scooting them down. You don't know like how tall are they. All right. Hey, I think there's a Sean in the way. Okay, cool. Yeah, Yeah. So generally before I start putting people in, I like to draw people in manually. So I'd like to like put people in like try to tell some type of story. Make sure the people help tell the story and go to the focal point. So maybe there's someone here and they're pointing. Maybe there's some people here. Maybe there's some people here. Maybe, and I do this kind of loose, maybe there's a guy here. And then there's some people in the background. Making sure like it looks, it has a nice rhythm to it. Like bam, bada bam, bam, bam. You know, it's like, they're not all like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They're not like standing in line all 6 feet apart. Yeah, I would change the style of the people and ages based on the design. Correct, Robert. Like if it's like a wintertime thing, I would do something wintertime. Summertime, I would change the people. A lot of times I get Chinese projects and everybody needs to be Chinese or Middle Eastern. If it's like a Middle Eastern project, yeah. So after I have this, then I can go ahead and drag in my people. And this part will be easy for me because I'm already prepared. So these are all PNGs. 1, 2, 3, 4. So generally my secret is, I would do maybe like 1 or 2 custom people that are really unique. And the rest of the people, I would just use stock, especially if they're towards the back. Oh, I have 2 people here. Okay, they fit there. That's good. All right, let's see what else. Yeah, this looks nice. Okay. All right, here. Basically, I'm just duplicating. Oh, no, that doesn't really make sense. Why would they be walking towards the wall? No, I don't like that. Yeah, I think this guy's good. I duplicate this layer, and I have a duplicate of that. Here you go, kind of like this. Trying to see what's good here. Okay, yeah, duplicate that. All right, here we go. Oh yeah, this works. And maybe some of you guys might be wondering, what if it's a kid? How tall is a kid? Good question. Well, the kid would just be half as tall as the parent. So let's say a kid is this tall. If the kid were to be all the way back there, they would just be, hold on you guys. They would be that tall. Can you guys see? So it wouldn't reach the full height, whereas an adult would be, let's see, these are adults here. All right. These are adults. Okay, so let's see. These are too high. All right. And this kid would be, oops, here we go, that tall. It kind of makes sense, right? Oh, no, this guy should be a little taller. But here you can kind of start to see a sense of perspective that, hey, the people are getting smaller towards the back, and you don't have to think about it too much. Okay, now what? Yes, rendering, all right. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and organize these layers here. I'm gonna merge all of these layers together just for ease. What am I doing on time? Okay, if I get to this before, yeah, I'm doing okay on time, I think. How am I doing on time, Melody?
Hi, you're doing great. We were going to take a break at 8:30, but that's obviously passed. You want to take a break in, I don't know, 6 or 7 minutes and answer a couple questions before we continue?
Okay, great, great. That sounds good.
Okay, yeah. So in 5, 6, 7 minutes, something like that, all right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool. So I'll go ahead and shade this in real quick. So I'm using a multiply layer, and I would do the shadow separately. So this is a pretty quick way of unifying all the people you have in a scene. There's something to note here, and I think that will be kind of cool. Watch these legs over here. Let me see, yeah, over here. Yeah, this is good. So what I would do is I would go ahead and after I do this layer of like this multiply, I try to keep everything really hard in terms of like the edges, and I can make it kind of like a blue. Hold on, you guys. Oh, hold on, I need to take this layer off. Yeah, and this is like a really natural like shadow layer that's really clean. But in some of the edges, I would kind of smudge them using my smudge tool, and it starts to look pretty realistic. Now, the part I just want to emphasize is that I'm not smudging everything. If it's a cast shadow, which means this is a cast shadow right here, because this jacket is casting a shadow, you don't smudge that. The cast shadows will be a sharp edge, while this will be a soft edge because it's called a form shadow. So you can start to see, it's starting to look pretty realistic, even though I didn't spend a lot of time on it. And when you have a lot of people in a scene, it's a way to unify everybody with like a pretty consistent look. And I'm gonna quickly do cast shadows on them as well. Okay, I'll do the cast shadows real quick and we'll take a break and we'll take some questions. I'm just using the lasso tool. And I'm just assuming the line is not there. If I were to do a cast shadow and like it's going on the line and everything, that's a lot of work. So I'll go ahead and just pretend like there's an empty floor, okay, you guys? Okay, that's a tool. I'm not doing exactly what the cast shadow is. I'm just kind of faking it. And using the lasso tool, it almost starts to look a little bit believable, especially from far away. Right, it's a little bit jagged. Like I'm not doing an exact cast shadow, and it's really fast, especially if you have like 20 or 40 people in a scene. And I'll go ahead and put this on a Gaussian blur, just a little bit. If it's closer to you, I would blur it more. If it's farther and further away, I would do less of a blur because it would be a sharper, smaller shadow. I would do something like this. Go. Cool. Here's some Indiana Jones music. Then I can make some parts of the shadow just a little bit darker, like this. And I have people. All right. I hope you guys like that mini demo. Cool. All right. So we can go ahead and stop for questions. I know there are a lot of really good questions. Melody, do you have any favorites that you'd like me to answer?
Yes, I do. Okay, so there's been a couple of questions that have been slightly answered, but I want to ask them again. Kelsey Connolly asked, do you know any recommendations for any online learning resources? Another member had a suggestion, but if any of you out there have suggestions, can you type them in? And Chris, we'd love to know if you know of any online learning resources.
I was about to cover that. I'm really glad you guys asked that question. Let me go ahead and share my, oops. Let me pause the music. The music became really loud. Let me show you real quick. Hold on. I need to like switch my switch my thing. What's going on here? What's going on? Here, I'm just gonna share this then. Okay, Concept Design Academy, Brainstorm School, CG Masters Academy. I'm also teaching a course. I'm not a big school, but I also offer some courses. We'll go over them real quick. I need to share Safari. Here we go. Concept Design Academy is really famous in Pasadena, California. They're kind of like the OG. They have a lot of different animation, storyboarding courses. Basically, it's like the caliber of Art Center, but you're only paying like $1,000 instead of like $200,000, but you get like the same teachers. So these are the same teachers who teach at that college, and you're paying only like $700 for a 10-week course. Brainstorm School, also these people used to teach at Concept Design Academy as well. Really great, really recommend them. Entertainment Design, Mechs, Speed Painting, Perspective. This CGMA course, I also highly recommend it. It's taught by Luke Stedman, who teaches theme park design, but it's a little bit more advanced if you haven't had like basic stuff yet. I did write a little article about it, about like the process of what the course is, so you can get a preview. And if you are looking for something kind of beginner based, only a few. I don't know how many people signed up, but I have this course, and basically you start learning perspective, two-point perspective, rendering, a little bit more rendering, and you do like a little prop design. It's a 6-week course. I have 7 spaces, and it's like a really small intimate class. Yes, next question.
Hey, Sarah first asked, what do you use for your digital sketching and photo layering? Obviously you're using Photoshop in this demonstration, but do you use anything else?
I exclusively use Photoshop, yes. Some people use Procreate and other 3D modeling tools, but I personally use Photoshop.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Cole Cox asked, do you have any tips for someone who hasn't done any digital art before? How do they get started?
Draw stuff that you like to draw. Draw stuff you're interested in. Some people think technique comes first. There's another school of thought that passion comes first. So if you like cars, draw cars. If you like pretty girls, draw pretty girls. If you like monsters, draw monsters. Anything you like, just draw it. And then you'll eventually get better. Drawing on paper is really good. And you can draw on the iPad if you want as well. Both are valid.
All right, thank you, Chris. The next question was from David Ackerman. He wants to know, how long did a rendering like that take you?
That one was kind of on and off for like, actually, I started it last year and I finished it this year, but I would say maybe like a week or so if I consolidated all the hours combined. It was pretty high level, but for a client, usually we need to finish a rendering in like 3 or 4 days. So we would be working on a more aggressive time frame. Yeah.
Okay. Let's see. Michael Irwin wanted to know, what are some of your most used shortcuts or tips for using your time efficiently in Photoshop?
Oh, hey, Michael, how's it going? Michael's one of my students from Australia. How's it going, mate? Yeah. I would say using your time efficiently in Photoshop, I like to have a timer. So I would set a timer for myself, like beep, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. And when the time's up, like you stop. So I think the timer and having the pressure there, you find ways to paint faster. Like you'll like when the pressure is there, when your back is against the wall, you'll figure out a way to do things faster.
Thank you. Okay, Nate Mitchell wanted to know, do you build custom brushes or do you have a good resource for ones that you use often for specific elements in your drawing?
Good question. Not that many custom brushes. But I do have, I'll show you some of my brushes that I use that I think are pretty good, okay? Let me see. you know what? Better than custom brushes, I believe, are the type of brushes. This is a round, hold on. This is a round hard. This is a soft brush. And then, what is it? This is like a rotational brush I have, which is pretty cool because it rotates with it. This is from, I think, John Park or Jamie Jones. You can like download his brushes for like, by signing up for his Patreon or something like that. But I think a really useful tip is that there's four type of edges, and then you'll start to realize that you don't need that many brushes. There's something, when I was learning figure drawing, it was called crisp, firm, soft, and lost. So when you're using your brushes, there's basically four things you need to know. If you want to create a crisp edge, this is a crisp edge. A firm edge is like, I'm using a hard round, and this is like firm. Like, it's pretty crisp, but not as crisp as a lasso tool. A soft brush is probably gonna be like, if I'm using an airbrush and I make it small, and this is a soft edge.
Hey Chris, we can't see your screen.
Oh no! Thank you for telling me. Shoot. Yeah. All right.
Here it is.
Okay, cool. So lasso tool, you can see I used a lasso tool. This is a crisp edge. This is like really clean. And this is a firm edge. I'm using a hard round brush and I'm kind of getting this firm brush, but it's not as crisp as the lasso tool. A soft brush is a small airbrush, and a lost brush would be, lost edge would be like this part. So I've just used an airbrush as well as like this. So it's not about the brush. That this is what most teachers say. As long as you understand the edges and like what the brushes do, then you don't need a lot of ingredients to cook. You know, like a really good chef can use really basic ingredients like flour, salt, whatever, and make something really good as long as they know how to use them.
Cool. Thank you, Chris. You ready for another question or do you want to get back into the art? Let me know what you
think. Yeah, sure. Just last one.
Okay. Juan Santizo wants to know, have you considered any 3D modeling or have you tried adding 3D into your drawings?
Yeah, absolutely. I do use 3D. Let me stop share and I will start share my other window and I'll show you my 3D modeling. Hold on, you guys. Here we go. Okay, here we go. Finder. Here we go. Okay. So you guys can see this good?
Yes.
Okay, cool. So when you go back, you will see a 3D model. It's drawn in perspective. Boom, 3D model. This is SketchUp. I use 3D models. SketchUp. Recently, I've also been using Planet Coaster, which is pretty wild. I'll show you that real quick. King Arthur Project. 3D renders. Maybe SketchUp? All right, here we go. Yeah, like this is from Planet Coaster. So it's not particularly 3D modeling, it's more like kit bashing. These are all 3D modeling assets. And the final illustration, that's not the final one. This isn't final, but you can kind of see how I'm using that 3D software to do a lot. You know, it's working a lot for me. So definitely recommend it. Blender is also very popular right now. I haven't used Blender yet. I've learned some Rhino recently. But in the theme park industry, a lot of people tend to use like AutoCAD, 3ds Max, because it needs to be built for production. It needs to be like engineered and built too. So people tend to use very serious 3D modeling programs in the theme park industry. Okay, yeah, that was the last question, right? So
We have a ton of other questions. But I'd like to maybe answer those at the end. I wanna make sure you get through the information you wanna get through. And again, guys, we're supposed to end at 9:30, but if we want to keep going with chatting after that, then that's fine. So you ready to get back into it, Chris?
Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to go. Wait, you still see my Finder window? Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So I think for like the webinar view, like because we're doing like a professional webinar, maybe this is like how it works, that we need a switch. So cool. Here are some storyboards, and I will be coloring in one of the storyboards today. If you've been following me on like Instagram or LinkedIn and stuff, you may notice that I've been doing these recently. So it's like a boat ride that's inspired by the Florida Everglades. You know, I've been hiking recently. So I was just like, there's like animatronic alligators. You go into like this really dense forest. I don't know if you've been to like Little Econ River Trail. Like, it's so cool. It feels like I'm in the Amazon. So I wanted to do something inspired by that. And you go inside like kind of like an avatar-ish looking cave. And then what happens, it's like a ride where you start to go up. Oh, we don't see that. Oh, we will do that storyboard. We'll do that rendering today. So let's go to this one. All right. Oh, wait, you've seen this one, right? I've seen this one. This one. And I'll kind of be showing you how I do like photo bashing and different things. And you can see here how I have a lot of different research and elements. And this is how I get a lot of those finishing effects, that kind of dazzle looking stuff. Okay. So for the demo, I'll go ahead and be showing you this illustration, how I finished this piece. So before it was like just something like, wrong file. This one. Before, I was just kind of showing you like how I start with starting a piece, and now I'm showing you how I finish it. So this is completely real, and I'm gonna go ahead and start some music, and I'm gonna get started. Oh wow, that music fit in really well. I think it'll be cool for me to just dissect this piece real quick for you guys. This is the original sketch. And what I did was I just did a little bit of cleanup line art.
Hey Chris, we can't see your screen.
Oh, thank you so much, Melody.
Thanks, James O'Shea.
Okay, hold on.
Also, can you turn the music down just slightly?
Yeah, sorry about that.
Thank you.
Okay, that better? All right.
Yes, much more clear.
Okay, sorry about that, you guys. All right, kind of see how I have these things on separate layers. And basically I just took the photo I originally had and used the warp tool and just kind of skewed it to my original sketch shape. So now I'm just gonna work like how I would normally work. I don't know, I may or may not be talking very much. I'm not really sure, but I think it'll be cool to kind of be like, hey, this is like real life. Like if I were to really do a project, like I'm like working for real. Oh, this light is blinding me. All right, cool. I'm trying to match it up to the sketch here. Perspective's not quite right. Let's see, what can we do? Something really cool, you guys. I know like you had the option of donating when you guys signed up for this thing. I'm happy to announce that we are at, can we say how much money we raised? We will be donating it.
Yes.
To how much did we raise, you guys?
I will check.
I thought it'd be really cool if we donated to a charity. So I was asking on Facebook, like, what are some good charities like to donate to? Because it's cool because it's like you're watching this workshop, but basically we kind of like did a charity fund. Like
yeah, exactly. We raised $220.
Oh, wow. That's awesome.
Thank you, everybody. That's awesome.
So I was thinking of donating to two different causes. Because Slice is like a Florida-based place, there's this organization called like the Florida COVID-19 Relief Fund. And there are some people, it started by my friends at UCF. And it's like for local Florida people, they're full Florida residents. And they're gonna like, you can apply for a grant if you need money and they'll hand out money. But right now they're accumulating funds. All right, cool. So the people are stretched out a little bit more than they normally would because I want to imply like a little bit of like motion. Yeah, let me see. So yeah, I'm happy with that. I'm happy. The perspective looks kind of weird. Here, the perspective over here looks off. Okay. It's gonna be more flat. Yeah, one thing I learned was like, don't get too precious with your piece. You know, don't be afraid to paint something over if you need to. Oh, and the other organization I was thinking about donating to, of course, would be like, for the healthcare workers, like protection, like donate PPG or something.
PPE. But
PPE, yeah. PPE. What does PPE stand for, Melody?
Personal protective equipment.
Yes. PPG, no. That isn't PPG like Procter & Gamble or something? I don't think they need donations.
You have not taken a security training at a theme park in a long time, Chris, if you don't know what PPE stands for.
I don't know what, oh, I see. Got it. No, I don't know what it's P like kids.
Yeah, no, it's PPE. It's when you work for the theme parks, they make you take all these, you know, security classes and safety classes, and they force you to know exactly what PPE is and all the different types, on a timely basis. So you have to keep taking these classes.
Oh shoot. Yeah. I didn't have to do that. I mean, I was just like a caricature and, you know, name painter. So maybe I wasn't like important enough to need to know. It's like on a need to know basis. I don't know.
Yeah, Dee Dee knows what's up.
Yeah. Yeah, you guys probably had more important jobs than I did. Now I'm doing like the secondary lighting.
While you're sketching, do you want to talk about how you broke into the industry?
Yeah, sure. I think my first job was with Goddard Group, surprisingly. It was one of my connections at Concept Design Academy who kind of recommended me for the job. I basically Googled concept design firm in Los Angeles, like concept design, theme park design firm near me in LA, and there happened to be like a lot of them. And I'm like, whoa, Thinkwell, Mousetrap, whoa, what is this? You know, like Hedema. I'm like, oh, okay, cool. So I emailed all of them and I just emailed them like, you know, every couple of months whenever I had new work. And eventually I got an opportunity to do like some freelance work for them, which was really cool. So, and then I joined TEA and I did a lot of stuff for the TEA. Like I was a photographer, got to know a lot of people. That was definitely really helpful. You know what? I'm gonna use a screen, maybe color dodge? I don't know. There we go.
So Chris, we're getting a bunch of questions, but I'm not sure if I should ask them now or later.
Now's okay. I'm not talking too much now.
Well, I don't wanna interrupt your thought process.
All right.
If you don't want me to.
If the question's too hard, I'll say, maybe I'll get like easy questions. Do you have any easy ones?
Let's see.
All right, I'm gonna drop some photos in. I'll see what happens.
Do you need to know about the construction process, like in order to make this concept work?
I think a little bit. Definitely a problem with a lot of game and movie concept artists is that a lot of their work is done in like digitally, right? So they can make a mountain like super big, but they don't realize that mountain would cost like $5 billion to make. So generally, if you know a little bit about like theater and you understand like, hey, making rock work is really hard, it costs a lot of money, do less rock work or make things whatever, like a little bit, yeah, it helps. I built those booths for Carnival, for Carnegie Mellon. So I have a general idea of like what it takes to paint a mural or make a wall or something like that.
Does that answer your question, Brendan Sullivan? He was asking about the technical construction process. Okay, thanks, Brendan.
I'm not an engineer or anything, you know, so it's not like I know like a ton.
Right, everybody seems to be agreeing with you here.
Like, if you were a video game concept artist, you know, like, they would need to know about, like, polygons and, like, gameplay and stuff like that. I'm not saying, like, oh, video game artists suck. Or, like, if you're a film artist, you need to know about, like, green screens. And, like, if you're a creature designer, you know, need to know a little bit about prosthetics. Like, I took a creature design class before. And then he was like, okay, so like, I'm designing this creature and I know that he's probably gonna be wearing a prosthetic and it's gonna be a suit and the rest is gonna be green screen or animation. Like knowing that process is helpful, you know, of the production process. Yeah, that's all right. So I'm gonna refer back to this sketch. So this is the feeling I want. I need to refer back to this. Kind of So I'm gonna like see this shape. I'm gonna try to match that shape a little bit. Nope. This layer, yup. Warp. Kind of push it upwards.
Okay, I have a question. I have a question that kind of ties into this. You were just showing a quick little pencil sketch that you just did. Jessica yes. Mariko asked earlier, would you consider like submitting one of those pencil sketches to a creative director or producer beforehand, or would you go straight into the concept art for presentation to a person?
Oh yeah, absolutely. You know, I would always show like a sketch or preliminary. This is probably a little bit loose if they're okay with it, but I usually would submit like some type of sketch beforehand to get approval. This way, we're not like wasting hours and time and money. We stay on budget and stuff. Absolutely. So drawing is important. There's a lot of people who go straight to 3D modeling. But if you draw, then it's like you make sure that everybody's on the same page before we spend a lot of time building the model. This is interesting. I think, I don't know. So my gauge of what I want to do is I'm looking at this sketch and I'm trying to, this sketch has so much energy. I don't want to deviate too much away from it unless I know that it really improves it. So I'm looking at this sketch and it's almost like my guide, my North Star. Ooh, that's kind of cool. Maybe I want like this. Like this? No. Stick with that. No, that's good. I'm gonna blur this part out a little bit.
Okay. I think the sound effects really help.
Thanks. Yeah.
I have a quick question for you from Angela Perrone. She wants to know, when you use source images, do you have to cite them or list any references when you submit your artwork?
Well, not exactly, but don't you have to change it enough where it's like where it's not obvious. I would say like the most important thing was like in theme parks you see people's faces. If someone's face is on there, you would need to make sure you get clearance, or your friend, you take a picture of your friend or something, or it's yourself. Because if someone is like, hey, Disney comes out with like a theme park artwork and it's like, hey, that's my face. Like, I recognize that's clearly my face. Yeah, you can get in big trouble. But if it's like, I'm doing some stars or something like that, really like disguise it so you can't you change it more than like 30 or 70, like change it like 70%, generally you're safe. But this is a pretty common practice in the industry to take photos and kind of manipulate them to what you want.
Yeah, I have to say that I had to do that once. I did this whole rendering and it was, it had some kind of recognizable faces in it. And so I had to go and take photos of my husband and my friend Anthony, who's watching right now. And I stuck all their pictures in my concept art. And so now they're super famous. Not.
Exactly.
I'm sorry, y'all didn't come here to listen to me talk. I'll shut up.
No, it's good. It's good. I like, I kind of like this format, how you're kind of like feeding me questions. It's cool.
Oh, okay. I can keep giving you questions. Some of them are a little more in depth, so I was kind of waiting to ask some of those later, but I'll ask a couple more. David Ackerman wants to know, paper versus Cintiq. How much do you use of each?
Oh, actually, I had a Cintiq at work before. I didn't really like using it that much for some reason. Like my arm, it would get tired. Right now I'm using this, you know, like $100 thing opposed to like that $2,000 Cintiq. But it's preference. A lot of people use iPads and Cintiqs. I prefer to keep like my hands like here and draw rather than this. I feel like this causes a lot of strain to your whatever muscle this is. Your supraspinous or something.
Okay, cool.
Hey, yeah, that's cool.
Let me see if there's any other easier questions. Well, what are you working on now? Tell us a little bit about your art and then I'll jump back into another question or two.
Oh, okay, cool. Right now, I'm just doing the values. I feel like I'm almost there finishing it up. Maybe I think this is too distracting. I'm liking it so far. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff going on. I'm doing a quick Gaussian blur of the background. Okay, I'm like, what do I do next? I look at this, I'm like, does it look like this? No, not quite yet. All right. Well, I'm noticing like the top here, there's some of these like motion lines. Okay, let's put that in there. Okay. Yeah, that way it brings out the silhouettes of the people. I just realized that. So this method of working opposed to what I was doing previously is a lot more spontaneous. It's really fun. Generally, I don't work this way with clients because they want to know beforehand. They want to like be in control and know what you're going to do. So usually with clients, I work the previous method where it's like line art, sketch, whatever. But this is like a personal piece. There's like 10 storyboards I'm doing. So it's a little, I get to be a little bit more spontaneous with it. Okay. I need to erase this. How are you doing on time? Should I be finishing this up in like 10 minutes?
Yeah, that's about right.
Okay, cool.
Josh Combs would like to know, for a pitch in the professional themed entertainment field, does digital illustration hold more weight than hand-drawn or painted concept art?
Ooh, I think that's a really great question. Depends on what percentage we're in. A lot of times creative directors would get me and ask me specifically because they want hand-drawn stuff. They want it to look sketchy. They don't want it to be too finished. Because when it's too finished, the client gets nervous if it's not like a finished product. So when we're in like 30% blue sky phase, they prefer like the hand sketch look. So they don't make the client nervous. But if it's like the final presentation, of course, like computer rendering, bird's eye view, they don't want hand sketches at that stage.
Okay, do you do, Theron Langhorn wanted to know, do you do color studies?
Color studies. Yo, Theron, how's it going? I used to do a lot of color studies. but now not anymore. I was gonna say what's more important than color study would be value studies. So I can turn this into a grayscale image real quick, and I see that it reads. So this is more important than the colors, because it's important that when it's really small, you can still tell what's going on. Like, you know what? At this point, it almost looks finished, almost. But just a small, like, let me change the value real quick. Now this almost falls apart because it looks like something is like farting water or something like that, because you don't see the people anymore, right? So if something doesn't have a clear silhouette read, something could quickly fall apart. So more important than color studies would be value studies. That's black and white, grayscale. That's what I mean, grayscale studies. But yeah, Darren's my friend. How's it going, man? Hope you're doing well. Okay. Go ahead and start doing some sparkles and wrapping this up. Are you gonna see how I do some sparkle? I have a sparkle brush. Oh, someone asked me, custom brushes. Yes, I do have a sparkle brush. Do these sparkles. Oh, that's cool. And then I would do an outer glow on them. Like, ooh, whoa, that's crazy. Wow, that's some scary stuff, huh? Wow, look at that. Yeah. I mean, probably not. Okay. Yeah, I mean, is this too like same? If it's also, green is kind of cool. What is the mood I'm going for? What is the story I'm trying to tell? You know, that's something I want to ask. So now you should be feeling a little bit afraid, actually, because you're going up, but also magical. Oh, no. Okay, yellow. Yellow, orange? I don't know. But yeah, having a lot of fun because like, I kind of get to experiment.
Kelly Bailey says green.
Yeah, the green was working before, huh? Like, sometimes your first choice just... Oh, man. That green is pretty... All right, cool. I want a little bit more detail on the people. I'm gonna go ahead and take... Oh, hold on. Oops. I'm like on my other window again. That's why you can't see me.
Yeah.
Taking my own painting to photo bash on top of my own painting.
Kalika Saracen says, how about pink and purple?
Pink and purple, yeah. I'm like, oh, hey, Kalika, CAD student. How's it going?
Hey, cool.
Right. Yeah, I'll probably add some pink and purple back onto it.
Here's a nice easy question from Theron. Are there some clients that are never happy with what you come with after endless revisions?
When I first started, yes. But I kind of viewed that more as like my fault because that was like my first couple of projects. And it was like one of my clients, when I first got started at a firm, they had to get like another illustrator to redo what I did. And I felt really bad. It was like my second project at the time. And I even had this one client where I submitted it. I worked to the best of my ability and it wasn't good enough. And he had to like repaint on top of it. And I felt kind of bad too. But that's when I was just first starting off. And you know, I asked for advice, like a Yelp review. I was like, hey, what did you think of my work? And he gave me some advice. He was like, yeah, like this is the finished thing. And I was like, whoa, what my client ended up having was way better than what I did. And I tried to learn from it. But generally, nowadays, most of my clients are pretty happy. In fact, now sometimes I need to repaint over other artists' work because I'm a little bit more senior now. And sometimes if a junior artist produces something that isn't quite up to par, they would send it to me and then I'll just, you know, touch it up a little bit for that final 10%. Cool. Let's just do.
There are some other questions, but I'm holding them until you can pause. I don't want to disturb your thought process.
Okay, cool. Thanks, Melody. All right. It's a little bit hard to, what is it called? So I'm going to do like a vertical motion blur, see if that helps me a little bit. Oh, that does. Yeah, but the sparkles aren't being motion blurred, so they shouldn't be motion blurred. So that means that if I were to, hypothetically, I just got an idea here. If I were to do this and motion blur this, this should look pretty good afterwards. I'm having like theories. Oops, wrong filter. Blur, motion blur. Ah, okay. It's like a drop tower ride, how you're going up and then you're gonna go down a flume. And okay. This boat wants to be motion blurred too then, I believe. Yeah, this boat wants to be motion blurred. Blurred. Motion blur. Okay, yeah, okay. I think that wants to be motion blurred. Oops, I don't need this. Okay, I'll probably touch it up a little bit more afterwards. On a different day, but I hope you guys find that entertaining, kind of fun. Hope you guys liked it. Yeah, you guys, Melody, I can do like more Q&A now.
Yeah, okay, great. Well, thank you, Chris. I learned a lot, and it's kind of just fun to watch someone else work. And yeah. Even just to watch your rhythm and how you're going back and you're not sure about things either, I think kind of makes me feel like it's okay if I don't know everything.
Yeah.
And it's kind of reassuring to watch someone else work. And so thank you for that. It's very, very helpful. All right. Hi, guys. Okay, so there's a bunch more questions and I'm not on video. Because I'm reading a lot, so I thought that would be distracting. Hang on one sec, let me pull up my notes.
You know what? I do want to say something, and it was the more classes I took, like I took a bunch of classes after I graduated from college, like a lot of the concept art classes. Let me turn off my music. I took a bunch of concept art classes because I thought I needed to get better. And the more classes I took, the more I realized I didn't need them because I was like, oh shoot, these teachers, they struggle too. Like all they're doing is like the same thing I'm doing. They're just spending time, get reference images, look at them, paint them, mess up, do it again, mess up, do it again. And like these guys from like Blizzard or Disney or Marvel, and they were just painting slowly, taking their time. Like they weren't like boom, 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 magic. It was like slow, hard work. And I was like, dude, I can do that too. They're messing up. They're not gods. They're just regular artists. They just take a lot of time.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you. Hello. Okay, I started my video. Okay, I have a couple of questions here. Derek Lewis wanted to know, in this piece you started with color and then you went into light and shadow. I know artists that start with light and shadow and then add color using blending modes on the shadows. What do you think are the pros and cons of each approach? And are there situations where each approach is better than the other? Does it make sense?
Good question. This is opinion thing. I would think that my opinion, because it's art, right? Like do your own way. A lot of people do it. So I'm gonna share my screen. Always start with black and white. So I started with black and white as well. And you can do a clean line art and blending modes and stuff like, but it's too messy. So what I just did was I did the stuff. Hold on, what was it like? Yeah, okay, check it out. So, multiply. Wait, no, what? Oh, here we go. See? Yeah, same thing, right? It's like, I'm still starting with black and white and it's kind of like blending modes, but I'm still working from black and white because you want to make sure the grayscale, it reads. That's the fundamental foundation of the illustration, to have a very solid black and white drawing and then go into color.
Okay. Derek Lewis would like to know, what tips do you have for finding work? Where do you go and who do you contact?
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely a lot. Like, I Google theme park design firm. Like, I could probably do it right now. It's my Safari on. I mean, right now, like, not a lot of people are hiring just because of COVID-19. Like, it right? But if, like, the economy does get better, I'm going to open this up. I have, like, YouTube videos on this. Like, theme park design firm. Depending on what you want. Okay, cool. Like all of this stuff, PGAV, iTech, BRPH, dynamic attractions. You know, there's a bunch of work. Email them and just keep on emailing them every like 3 months, 1 month. Like, I mean, like, you don't want to be annoying, but like, follow up with them, go to TA. I mean, it's all right here. We can go to contact us. And then, you know, it says other job opportunities, visit our careers page. Right? Do this for like 30 different companies. And I'm sure I'll give you money if you message 100 companies and not one of them responds back. You know, so it's just about that hustle, message a lot of them, cold call, cold email. Yeah. And grind.
Well, I have to also mention Slice.
Yes.
That we try to help you find your niche in the community as well, and try to introduce you to the right people at the right time. Creative directors in the industry, particularly in the Orlando area. Of course, we have many clients from all over the United States, but you know, our strength is in Orlando because it's where we're based. So we're happy to help you guys find your way too. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me, Melody, at Slice Creative Network. Yeah, Tom Renoff is going through the Slice application right now. Hello. Okay, so next question. Michael McNaught wanted to know, what would you do differently if you were back in school now?
Oh, that's a great question. I think if I were back in school, I would probably just... Oh, geez, I don't want to say I would drop out of school, but I would probably take those Concept Design Academy classes more seriously, build up a portfolio, and start getting work. I think I assumed that because I had a degree and I got decent, good grades, that I would get a job. But I mean, like, as a concept artist, it's different if you're an engineer or a doctor or an architect. You need that degree, you need that license, right? Like, you don't want an architect who doesn't know like how to make the building solid. But as an artist, make sure to have a really good portfolio. I don't think I was taking it that seriously at the time. I was just trying to pass my classes and get good grades.
Okay. Walter Bone had two questions. He wanted to know, what's the best Photoshop class for this kind of work? And then I'll ask the next question in a second. Do you have a good Photoshop class that you can recommend?
How advanced is he? Like beginner, intermediate, advanced?
Walter Bone.
I would say take my Photoshop class because I'm offering one.
Yeah, y'all. How do people find out about that? From your website?
Yeah. I just set it up. This is really cool. ChrisChien.com. So I wouldn't say I'm like the best Photoshop teacher, but I do try to make my classes really fun and engaging. how it's a focus with on themed entertainment and how the workflow is. It's a little bit different from games and movies, so I try to specialize. But I would say that anything you see here isn't proprietary information. You can find it online by reading books. I think if you were to enroll in my class, it's really about the experience. And what that means is the commitment, you know, being held accountable to do the homework, right? Having classmates around you, a positive group energy, you know, having fun and sticking with it. Kind of like I can tell you to go do push-ups, run a couple of miles and do pull-ups, you know, during, you know, this COVID-19 crisis, but are you going to do them? And, you know, my class is just like, hey, I want to make sure like, hey, like 5 more reps, keep running, you can do it, you know, like, so I think mentally, emotionally is just as important as a technique. And that's what I try to do in my class.
Great. Thank you, Chris. His second question was, do you have any suggestions for storyboarding between hand versus digital? He wanted to know, it says percentage phases during the design process. And Walter, I'm not sure what that means, but do you have any suggestions for storyboarding differences between hand versus digital?
I don't really do storyboarding very much. I prefer hand because I think it's faster for me. That's just me. But if you're doing digital, there's a lot of advantages, like plotting things in perspective. Or if you want to draw like 50 guys, like let's say you're drawing like Iron Man and you need to draw him like fighting 50 enemies, you can quickly duplicate that in on the computer. But there's a lot of really good storyboard artists out there, but I'm not like a storyboard artist. I don't specialize in that. So I'm not really sure.
Okay, thank you. James O'Shea wanted to know, do you use any project management apps to organize your projects like Trello or anything similar?
No. I don't, I'm a really old school person. Like I have a calendar here of all my stuff. I handwrite it. I really like traditional things. So I don't even use like iCloud, iCalendar or Google Calendars.
Man, you're old school. Okay, Darius Chong had a couple questions as well. He wanted to know, do you sometimes get layouts or 3D models from other designers, and what is that process like?
Yeah, absolutely, Darius. Hey, what's up? It's my friend. I think he's been Malaysia or Singapore. Sorry, man, I forgot. But he's really good too. Yeah, so a lot of times I'd get him from like the engineering team, you know, like hardcore Revit, like engineering stuff. And that's super cool, where everything is precise to like, if I make one wrong line, the architect guy comes and he'd be like, hey, Chris, you drew this line 1 centimeter off. Like, I can tell it's wrong. And then that's when you have to be like really precise. So it's fun because now they're talking to me about like trusses and the, what's another architecture term? Like something Chad would use. I don't know. Like, you know, like I learned architecture stuff, terminology, like, oh, the column you use is a Corinthian column. And that's obviously not correct because it needs to be a another type of column. I don't know. Yeah, I love it. It's really fun and educational.
Cool. All right. What are some of the greatest challenges you face when working with people from other disciplines?
Yeah, I definitely think like, for me personally, I really love my work. I love working. I think the biggest challenge I would find is when they want to go to a bar and go out and drink and stuff like that. I don't like doing that kind of stuff. I really like when people are passionate about their work and are interested in improving and getting better. I'm kind of like a nerd in a sense. So I get along with other nerdy people, whether or not it's theater nerds, architecture nerds, interior design nerds, like we really get along. But if it's like party, it's more of a personality thing, if anything at all.
Okay, Zachary Chizinski wants to know, how do you go about doing thumbnails for environments for personal work? Do you do studies or have some kind of idea for story or maybe a certain subject for a focal point for personal work?
Personal work? No, I don't do thumbnails for personal work. Really, maybe a little bit, but what I would start with would be like the photo. Like let's say I'm doing like a flat ride. I'll get a lot of references, like what does the flat ride look like? What did other artists and concept artists do in terms of like this point of view? And I'd look at that and be like, okay, it looks like the ratio and the scale is like this. So then I'd create my own thumbnail after doing reference and research.
Okay.
Oh, wait, but good question. The thumbnail thing, I think, usually applies more to movies because you're establishing the camera angle. That's really important in movies because you're establishing that view. For theme parks, there is like basically one view, and that's you're standing like 5 feet on the ground. Like you, that's usually what the client and stuff want. Like, what is it gonna look like after we build it? You're gonna be standing around like 5 foot tall or 6 foot tall. So there's less choice compared to film.
Makes sense. Joey Fisher wrote in and he said he recommends Storyboarder software, and he says it's amazing and it's free.
Cool.
Great. Thank you, Joey Fisher. Okay. Let's see. Who else do we have? George Rithu. He says, I want to be a theme park designer. How do I know if this is the right path for me?
I don't think you know. You won't know until you do it. Go ahead and try to get the job. Maybe you waste 1 to 2 years of your life and you realize you hate it, but 1 to 2 years from the overall view, you have another, I don't know how old you are, you still have another 20, 30, 40 years. Like, let's say you're 40 years old and you want to be a theme park designer. You still have like another 30 years to work or something. So I think it's just perspective that we have time.
Mm-hmm. Just try it out. See where it leads you. Okay. Let's see. Farron Langhorn again wanted to know, if you analyze a concept designer's portfolio, what specific elements are you looking for? Are you looking for skill or are you looking for quantity?
I don't usually hire other concept designers. I think nowadays what I'm really interested in, before I would look for skill, right? Quantity, I don't think most people will say don't focus on quantity, even though I have a lot of work in my portfolio. They would prioritize quality over quantity. So just make sure your work is the best work that you have there. But even more than that, in the theme park industry, I would say to have relevant work. Like if you're drawing a picture of like video games, like mechs and stuff like that, that's not gonna really fly for people who want theme park work. So in my portfolio, I designed, I think I did a fan art of like Sugar Rush, like a racing thing, a go-kart track. And then after I submitted it to Thinkwell, right, I got called back like I think a couple weeks later for a, it was an attraction that was car-based. So you want to show them exactly what it is. So I recently did this boat one with a sparkly thing, and I got a client, and then they said they wanted me to do that sparkly effect on that illustration. So it's called like the red truck rule. If the client wants a red truck, you got to show them a red truck in your portfolio. So Darren, maybe you're right. Maybe quantity is important in terms of having variety. Like the client wants it in blue, you got to show blue in your portfolio. That's what my professor told me, yeah.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. Okay, Ben Minke says, he was wondering, I saw a lot of work on your site that is IP-based, like Pokemon and Final Fantasy VII, and I was wondering if that is using an IP in your portfolio more of a plus when applying to different places, or are they more of passion projects?
I don't know. I think they're more passion projects. I have heard that it even hurts me, because I have heard like, oh shoot, like they're afraid that if you go in, they'll think that they stole your idea or something like that. I've had people tell me like, oh dude, you're doing too many IPs. But I don't know, like I'm really passionate about it. I really like what I'm doing. You know, maybe I should ease down on it a little bit. So I guess it's personal, but I think you don't want to do too much because you don't want to get into like legal trouble You know, I do make sure to say, hey, this is fan art purposes. This is not official concept art for Disney or something like that. I try to make a little footnote whenever I can.
Okay, right. Derek Lewis commented that Disney IP is a huge no-no. Yeah, agreed. Okay, Kelsey Stridio wants to know, do you have any books or videos or anything you recommend to people who are just getting into concept art? And I think you already covered a little bit of that, but do you have anything else to add? So any books or videos, anything to help people get started with concept art?
You can go to YouTube, search concept art, and click on the video that you like the most, you know, that seems appealing to you. There's so much information out there. We're surplus of information.
Agreed. Dee Dee wanted to know, what is the best platform for displaying a portfolio? I guess she means, is it he or she? I'm not sure, but this person means, I guess, when you're presenting in person. That's what I'm assuming this person wants to know. Maybe he or she can chime in and ask.
I don't know. So a lot of video game artists use something called ArtStation, but I feel like in the game industry that works, but in the theme park industry, I would say LinkedIn, believe it or not. Like, post on LinkedIn regularly and you get a lot of engagement because there's not a lot of artists there. It's just supply and demand. You know, most of the time people are posting like business related stuff and they get excited when they see a nice looking piece of artwork. And of course have a website or Instagram or something like that. But I post a lot on LinkedIn and that's working for me.
Yeah. And I have to say, you know, running Slice and hearing from clients on a consistent basis over the last 9 or 10 years, most people want you to have a website with your work on it to be able to confirm that you're legitimate and you're a serious professional. So I would definitely highly suggest having a website portfolio.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So Patrick Kling, hi Patrick, wants to know if someone wanted to build up their portfolio, what are recommended pieces you'd have them work on?
If someone wanted to build up their portfolio, probably like a POV. I guess it depends on what you're passionate about. What were my first pieces? I did like a, as long as they're like kind of theme park related of what you wanted to do, like I did like a Sugar Rush one, a Lord of the Rings one, and like a Tron Tomorrowland one. They were all kind of IP based, but it was cool because when I submitted to directors, if they were also a fan of the IP, it really helps give you an in. As long as it's theme park related, don't just draw like mountains and a lake and some people standing there, you know, like if you want to be a theme park, just find a flat ride, redesign it, add some people in there, make it pretty. You got a portfolio piece.
Yeah. And I would also, if I can chime in again, you guys didn't come here to hear me talk, but I've already started. I was going to say a lot of younger people coming out of school, love to include their hand drawings and hand renderings in their portfolio of things that are not related, just to show that they can draw by hand. And that's not generally appealing to clients. It is important if you do know how to draw by hand, but I would recommend if you do fall in that category to work on another project, a theme park related project, and do some hand sketching and include that on your portfolio and nothing else with the hand sketching. Okay.
Oh, wait, Melody, are you saying talking about the people who would draw like an apple and like a vase in like pencil?
Yeah. Or like,
yeah, don't do that.
Any kind of still lives or like figure drawings, and you know, because a lot of students have done, you know, a ton of drawing classes, mm-hmm. myself included. And, you know, you have just a ton of work from it. And so of course they want to showcase their ability to draw by hand. And that's generally not appealing to theme park clients. So I would exclude that.
Yeah, it says student.
Yeah. And thanks everyone for saying nice things to me on the chat. Okay, Brendan Sullivan. Oh, this is a good question, Chris. Brendan Sullivan wants to know, do you like to try different creative things to recharge your batteries? And if so, what do you like?
Recharge my battery. Wait, can you say that question one more time? I just saw one of my students in the chat. Her name's Roseanne. Hi, Roseanne. Just want to shout out to her.
Cool. Okay, so Brendan Sullivan. Batteries, right? Sorry? Yes. Brendan Sullivan wants to know, do you like to try different creative things to recharge your batteries? And if so, what do you like? What do you do? You're feeling like creative. What do you call that? When you just can't, you have like a block, creative block. Like I just had.
Go out, exercise. But I do try to limit the amount of creative stuff I do in a certain day, in amount of number of hours. Going out, exercise, eating healthy, I guess that kind of stuff. Now we can't really go out as much. So now it's just hiking, walking, taking a walk around my apartment and stuff.
Yeah, getting active away from your computer.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like to draw by hand. If I'm on my computer and I just like can't think anymore, there's something about my relationship with a pencil and a piece of paper that just kind of opens my mind in a way that the computer can't. So I sometimes I'll like go into another room and grab my sketchbook and my pencil and just kind of try to clear my mind and just move my hand, and eventually something comes out and I kind of come out of my block. That's how I do it.
Mm-hmm. Melody, but you know what? The thing I struggle with the most isn't like the creative part, it's the physical part. So does anyone here struggle with like carpal tunnel, tennis elbow, that type of stuff, right?
Yeah, I do.
So that's something I really focus on recently, you know, doing different exercises for the wrist. I looked up like yoga wrist stretch on YouTube and I found someone, so I try to do that where you're like doing different exercises. This is like the ulnar and carpal, like flexor stuff, like different stretches, really important, you know.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, everybody's chiming in. They're like, yes, me too. Craig Stickler standing right now.
Yeah.
Cool. Thanks, everybody. Okay, Lindsay wanted to know, what's the best way to become more familiar with fabrication construction materials used in concept art? And I know we had a comment from Nate Mitchell here, which I think he was saying that, oh, I can't find it, the chat is so full now. But I believe Nate Mitchell was chiming in and saying to like start working with construction vendors and to work with them as much as possible and you'll become more familiar. Do you have anything to add to that, Chris, about how to become more familiar with construction materials?
I mean, it's not like a low budget thing where you can just buy a bunch of resin and like plaster and start like, it's a lot, it's like if I were to buy a pencil and a sketchbook, that's a really small investment, but buying a bunch of like 2x4s and plywood and start making stuff, that's a little bit harder, isn't it? But on the other hand, I found that scenic shops tend to be really friendly. So if you were to email them saying like, hey, you're a student, can I stop by and take a tour? Like shout out to like Sally Darkrise. I went to visit them during a TEA event in Jacksonville. And they said that they regularly give tours to elementary school students. So they're really open about that. And I think that's a good way to reach out to a show set design, like Nassau or Lexington and stuff. I toured Lexington before in LA for a TEA event, and they're very generous by opening their doors and giving us a tour as well. So that helps to tour a fabrication facility.
Yeah, I agree. And you know what? I'd like to do more of that with Slice once we can be back in the world again. Because we did a couple of tours. We did one of DCL. We wanted to do one of Scenario here in Orlando, but we couldn't because of the virus. But anyway, it's really great. And we learn so much every time we go in. And yeah, I think you're right. Construction firms are really cool. And a lot of these people on the chat work for them as well. Oh, there's a bunch of people that have to leave. Thanks for coming.
All
oh,
right.
Thanks for
being hey, there. Guys.
But I have a couple more questions. Don't leave, Chris. I know it's late, but two more questions, okay?
Okay.
All right, Josh Combs. Hi, Josh, if you're still here. Wants to know, do you include storyboards and development sketches in your portfolio?
Yeah, kind of. Yeah, yeah. Actually, it's really popular with clients. I do have it on my website. I think I can do like a quick share. Safari here. Yeah. So I currently don't have storyboards, but I do have a lot of sketches. Like over here,
not
I have
nude
like
sketches though, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, like,
I'm just kidding.
Yeah, yeah. Like this type of stuff. Like, but it's not like a bicycle or a still life or something. It's like of like Beam Entertainment stuff. And this is like the first round. Like when I go to a client and they're like, hey, can you give us some sketches by tomorrow? Like this is, I would draw something like this and give it to them. And they would be like, hey, we need exactly like this. We like this stuff on your website. We want you to do something at this level. So, yeah, it's really helpful. It's really popular with clients, surprisingly, even though it's not that pretty.
Yeah, I agree. That's almost the number one requested thing with clients reviewing portfolios on Slice. They're asking, what is the person's process like? How do they start? How is the middle? And then how is the end? And because they really want to know what programs you work in, you know, how you get from A to B. So I would say absolutely include storyboards and sketches.
Absolutely, La Process. I totally agree. I think Chris Doe, he's a Art Center YouTuber. He covers that. Like, you really need to show your creative recipe so people know what they're getting. So clients don't choose the best possible option. He says that clients choose the least risky option. Like when you buy a brand on Amazon, you're like, which one has the best reviews? So you get to kind of see how I created this image from start to finish. So before you even hire me, you already know what you're gonna get. You see that, hey, I'm doing master planning. Hey, I do a 3D model. So before you hire me, you already know what my creative formula is. And like I was saying, this YouTuber, Chris, he's a professor and an educator. He really stresses that it's really important. And this is what inspired me to create all these tutorials, not just to help people and benefit the community, but this is, I think it's good for clients to know how I work.
Yeah, definitely. Cool. That was all the questions we had. Does anybody else have more questions? Chime in. And also, while waiting for questions, if there are any, Bill Keevy, thank you, Bill, who I guess works at Sally, says the tours are closed right now. Sally Dark Rides. He says normally Sally does them on Tuesday and Thursday, and they will start doing them again once things cool off. So thanks. I'd love to have a tour of Sally. So thank you for that information. That's great. Anybody else have questions? Oh, Malena Artigas wrote, how much time do you leave in between touch-ups or when a design needs to rest? Not sure what that means.
I see. You know, I'm not the person who binge does this. If anything, I do less than what I'm actually capable of. Like this. So like even drawing for like 20 minutes, 30 minutes, like I would just do that instead of drawing for like 2-3 hours at a time. Number one, I find the 20-30 minute thing is really healthy. So I don't sit too long and my wrist doesn't get too cramped up. So I always take breaks, 30 minutes, an hour. So I come back and then I'm fresh. So yeah, I don't sit and like binge draw. Like a lot of artists tend to do that, but it's not really, they realize like, hey, it's bad for your arm.
Right. Okay, I think the last question we have a couple of fun questions. Patrick Kling wanted to know, how do you learn more about ride systems?
Oh, good question. But you know what? When I was working at BRPH, it was an architecture engineering firm. We had to talk to a lot of ride vendors. And, you know, because they're an engineering firm, right, an architecture, I had the opportunity to do that. And that was really cool. So we got to interact with ride vendors a lot, look at like the layouts and like the capacity and different things like that, like really technical side of things. But I don't know how a normal person would do it. You could probably look up ride vendors like Zamperla, look through their books. They have pamphlets and brochures, I guess.
Speaking of Zamperla, we have Benton Shortridge online right now from Zamperla.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know Benton. You, but now you know me.
Yeah.
So that's awesome. Thanks for joining, guys. All right. Oh gosh, everyone's writing and I can't keep up. Yeah, thanks everybody for joining. Let me see if there's any more questions. Brendan Asaf wants to know, is there a best way to move from designer to an art director role? Do you have any tips on that, Chris? Do you know
how to answer? No, because I am not an art director, right? So I will not give information that I do not know about.
Okay, very good. Bill Keeby says some ride vendors, piggybacking on the ride vendor question, some ride vendors have PDFs with data that can be downloaded and you can pull it from their websites. Mm-hmm. So that's great. Ah! Thank you. Okay, engineering, architecture, IP, and different worlds. Do you need to be a know-it-all or how do you bring... Okay, sorry. Juan Santizo says, engineering, architecture, IP, different worlds. Do you need to know it all? Or how do you bring all those factors into your sketch? Yeah, it does seem like a lot of information, right? That we have to know about ride systems, construction methods, you know, it's a lot. And do we need to know all about all of that to make a good piece of concept art? That's a really good question.
You know what? It's definitely really hard. Not a lot of people teach theme park concept art. Maybe this is why. Okay, so just to be a concept artist, right? You need to know about like industrial design, character design, like figure drawing. You need to draw people. You need to draw like lighting and painting. It's already like a mixture of stuff. Learning concept art used to be like hard in itself. And then learning theme park design is also hard. There's storytelling, architecture, engineering, theater. And then now you have to combine both of those things together. It's like combining a unicorn with like a sphinx, like a dragon lion, you know? So you have to like polymerize like two like already hybrid things together. So know a little bit of everything, I guess. Try. It's not easy, but do your best. Yeah, it's not easy.
I think every concept artist has strengths and weaknesses, which makes the concept art world really interesting and fun. And it just allows a lot of concept artists to even work together in different ways. Because some people are great concept artists for like theater or whatever, because they know all about the theatrical set design process. And some people are great at, like you were mentioning earlier, costume design, and they're really good at that. And so I find running Slice, again, I'm up again from my Slice perspective, I find artists really fascinating for that reason, because everybody is different and it's beautiful. I love it. Okay, that was all the questions we have. Right. Yeah, thanks everybody for all the love on the chat thing. I'm sorry, I keep looking down. The screen's so big. thanks everybody. Does anybody else have anything else to ask? Do you have any last minute plugs you want to give, Chris?
hey, you know, I do want to say like, thank you for everyone for giving me this opportunity to speak. Definitely an honor. If I say anything that was incorrect, right? Maybe like it's a slip of the tongue, or maybe it's just like I was wrong factually about something, please forgive me. I don't know everything. So maybe everything I said wasn't like correct. You know, this is going to be on YouTube. There's going to be someone commenting below like, well, actually, and Disney, blah, blah, blah. The rule is blah, 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 blah. And then, yeah, I'm sorry in advance. Yeah, thank you so much for allowing me to showcase what I'm passionate about. I really like teaching. I really like the learning process. And I had a lot of fun. Thanks for coming out, guys. It's not easy to get. Right now there's 70 people, like to get 70 people in a room, like a presentation, that's huge. Thank you guys so much for this honor.
Yeah, thanks everybody. And last minute plug for Slice is, we're doing the Slice virtual mixer on Tuesday, May 26th at 7 p.m. Eastern. So I hope you guys will join us for that. And it's free for Slice members. So if you're hosted on the Slice website, you get in for free. And if you're not a member, then it's only $5. So we hope to see then. We're going to have some fun games and some social things and also some professional networking happening all live next in two Tuesdays, May 26th. So I hope you guys will join us. Thanks, everybody. Again, this will be up on YouTube, and have a great night.
All right. Thanks, guys. Thank you, everybody.
Bye.